what are apparently some advanced features for some people, common knowledge for others. It's just ways to use a tool. It's another tool. There's a lot of really great features for these CTFs. There's different ways to do this. This is not the only solution. In fact, I'll tell you, for some of these CTF things, there are greatly simpler solutions besides what we're going to do in Wireshark, but that doesn't give me an excuse to talk about Wireshark. So, who am I? Chris Cooper. I'm a network engineer for a filtering company called SIPA Filter. We do K-12 stuff. If you really care, I'll talk your ear off later, but I do a lot of network investigations, a lot of protocol compatibility stuff, spend a lot of time dealing in Wireshark. So let's cover a little bit about, jump right in, besides the first couple of flags here. Slide deck's mostly a start, you know, we'll jump in. So these were the first couple of flag examples we could see. The first four come out of one PCAP. So I'm just gonna show you all four flags and we're just gonna sort of work through them as a group, talk about it, show you some of the tips and techniques that I use to find the flags. So we had an eight legs part due, a 114, and some sort of gibberish, which, anyone know what that might be? Common encoding type for CTFs? Base 64, exactly. If we throw that in base 64, I believe it was 3747. Oh, let me grab my cheat sheet. Yep. Close enough. All right, so all these usually are some sort of hint if you haven't done any of the CTFs before. So it kind of gives you an idea as to what some of this stuff might be. Things like eight legs part two sounds like spiders, so probably going to be something with web traffic analysis. 114. Start throwing out there a couple things. Maybe we're talking about a port 114, 114th packet, a couple ideas to work with. And then base 64, if we decode it, should give us something that'll let us move a little bit further in. So let's go ahead and fire up some Wireshark here. Things are a little small, a lot of screen real estate. Wireshark works much better with the bigger screen. The bigger you can get, more screen real estate. It means more fields you can have, more data you can look at the same time. Good example of this is on any given individual packet, there's a hex dump that lives down here. But for the sake of you guys wanting to read something, we're just going to hide that for right now, bring it up if we need it. This is kind of the first intro that everyone sees for Wireshark. This is mostly a default config. You open it up, you got packets, 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 packets. So, where do you start? One of the things for me is there's a lot of TCP traffic, and it's kind of hard sometimes to keep track of what streams what and where they do. So one of the very first things I do whenever I get a new Wireshark install is I'll go ahead and click on something. If we come down and drill into any of these protocols below here, here we're looking at TCP, there's a option for a stream index. This is where Wireshark, when it opens, there's usually a delay. It does some pre-processing on packets. It'll go through and look at every single TCP stream, and it'll figure out which packets belong to what stream. It's using the tuple, your IP addresses, your ports, sequence numbers. It does all that analysis, figures out what packets go with what. That comes with the stream index. Any one of these fields that you see down here, we can always just right-click on and say apply as column. What it does is add us a new column anywhere in the or up here in the top interface that lets us see at a glance as we go down what those packets are. So now as I'm just kind of quickly glancing through, I can see that these three packets are going to be related, and they're related to this traffic, whereas this request is something separate. So we're doing a CTF. We know we're talking about spidering, but there is an obscene amount of data here. We're going to roll down, and if we get down to the bottom, we have 2,500 packets to dig through. It would take forever to start digging packet by packet, but we have to start somewhere. One of the things that I think is underutilized by a lot of people is the statistics system. Wireshark actually can pull a lot of data out of a PCAP for you and give you somewhere to start. Generally, my first stop anywhere is this protocol hierarchy. Just gives you an idea of what's there. can see that all of them are IPv4. As we dig in, 195 of those are UDP. It's a combination of, there's a couple of NTP packets, two of them. There's some DNS traffic that we may want to look at. And then we have, in our TCP, the majority here, 36% of it is TLS. It's encrypted. We probably can't get too much without decryption keys. We could get host names out of it, maybe some handshake stuff, but we're dealing in the first flag. Odds are they're not going to make us dig that deep for it. However, what we do have on here is a couple interesting things. We see Hypertext Transfer Protocol, HTTP. That's a clear text protocol. There's probably something there we could look at. And there's an FTP protocol. FTP is also in the clear. That gives us a target somewhere we might be able to start working. So if we want to go back and look at those statistics, one of the other options we have to start with here is there is a HTTP decoder. So we saw we had a bunch of HTTP traffic. Maybe we'll just take a glance and go, give us a quick summary of all the requests that we can find. Well, this will automatically go through, strip out all the requests, and present what we have. We have five different host names that we saw a request to. We saw at Google. But we have one request, and it's to the root of Google. Probably not a whole lot there. OCSP, a couple of requests. OCSP is used for validating SSL certs. So these are probably related to those TLS sessions we saw. Again, most likely not something there. This is kind of general background noise. Another request to Google. And then this curious domain, flags.saltysec.com. That seems really interesting to me. We see some JavaScript loaded for it. Looks like WordPress, maybe basic stuff. And then these two pages it pulls, a P5 and a P11, so some sort of page index. Just at a glance here, this would be where I'd start, because it says flags. We're looking for flags. So the long way is we could dig through down here. We could say, look at all our HTTP requests, type in our filter. HTTP, there's a secondary one. We could say http.host. We could say HTTP host equals, double equals, let's say. flagsaltysec.com, we're going to grab it. Now, how do I know where to make that filter? Where'd it come from? Well, let's clear it out and grab any web query. This is the easiest way. There's all sorts of APIs you can dig through, but again, we're a CTF. We're time limited. We don't have time to go dig through Wireshark API looking for a specific host field. Okay, we can pop down here and go in our decoder. We have ourselves a HTTP, and there's a host. If you right-click on it, again, we could say instead of apply as column, we could say prepare as filter selected, and it's going to show right up here the exact text that they put in to filter it. So you can grab any HTTP packet, regardless of the host, grab it, go, oh, okay, this is what they're calling that field. I can throw values in that I care about. But it has really good support for HTTP. So yes, we could go digging packet by packet, and it would work. But what we're going to be doing is looking at a bunch of stuff like this. We could even go dig down and start looking at the hex. If anyone reads gzip compressed, you're a better man than I. or one of the common ones most people know is you could go on ahead and we're going to say follow TCP stream. If we follow TCP stream, it's going to show us the raw stream assembled. We have red is from the client, blue is from the server response. As we come down, I'm like, okay, cool. We have a request for git slash. And then we come further down and go, okay, we have the response. And it's garbage. Again, it's because we're looking at content encoding gzip. What this is gzip data that makes up the site. Problem is, it's not real human readable. We could go on ahead. We could do a save as a raw. We could take the raw output. We could do a save as, dump it to a file, throw it into something else to extract it. But this is a real common task. Wireshark already has things for this. If you notice, when we go through and follow, if we grab an HTTP packet, we can say follow instead of the stream. We can follow an HTTP stream. What this is going to do is Wireshark's going to go on ahead and automatically decode the gzip encoding for us. So now, that same stream we're looking at that was compressed data now gives us something closer to source code. This gives us something we could start digging through and go, hey, what do we got? You know, hunt through, you know, maybe good, maybe not. We could, again, say if we want to hit save as, we could save this out, dump the stream out to a file, grep it, search it, whatever you'd like. There's also a find down here. So we know all of the flags that SecDSM used for the CTF were in the format of SecDSM and then bracket, some sort of random characters, another bracket. Find, we don't find it. So let's go look at maybe some of the other things for it. If we, maybe we grabbed the wrong one. We're looking at slash here. So let's go look at some of these files. We could jump through and say export objects. So rather than having to pull up each HTTP stream individually and export it, we can go directly to export objects and say we want to look at all our HTTP traffic. What do you got for me? Wireshark, again, is doing that pre-analysis, has found all the files, and has them in a format where we can grab an individual file, and we can hit save, dump it out to a folder, and there's the HTML file extracted from the stream. A couple of things that are interesting on this is we see somewhere down here there was an image. Image came through. I don't remember necessarily seeing that in the request, but again, we're in a hurry. All right, that's kind of cool. And we have these couple of mystery pages. Tell you what, let's go on ahead and we'll start with the image just because that's easy. We could save as and open it, but again, Wireshark has a lot of these decoders. If you notice, it's kind of hard to see, but if I double click on one of these, oh, let me clear my filter here. If we double click on one of these, you could see over on the left here, as I click, it's jumping around, so we're on packet 1050. If I want to click on that image, it jumps us to packet 1084. Come back over. If we right-click, we can do follow our HTTP stream again. That was our the request. Oh, where are we at? So let's do follow HTTP stream. Oh, this was a page. Did I click the wrong one? I may have clicked the wrong one. Downside of doing this on a giant, giant screen. Try you again. There we go, 1084. There we go. So you see on the right, this decoding, it says this is a PNG file. If we right click, not only can we do a, we can do our follow HTTP stream. We're gonna get that. We should be able to, well, where did they throw that? Give me 1 second here, grab it. Oh, there it is. It is in. Thank you. Boop, 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 boop. Show packet in new window. Why am I not? Oh, come on. I think it has fallen off the bottom here. Ah, there we go. PNG. Bop, 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 bop. So if we come down here and grab the PNG in our decoder, we can actually right-click on a PNG and just say show packet bytes. Wireshark has a built-in image decoder. Again, if you're doing this for malware analysis, it's processing protocols, perhaps not do it as admin on a system you care about because you're dealing with live malware in a sample. never. Not like they keep patching it to fix vulnerability, fix error. But again, so here we go. We have one of the flags. We can throw this in. If we throw it in, we'll try it for flag one. It's going to come back bad. But we did see there was an eight legs part due. If we try this for part due, we have a success. We have points on the board. But that means our first flag is still somewhere in here. I'm guessing it's probably not far off. So we can go dig through some of these streams again. Or, oh, let's see here. Go back to the objects. Gonna jump to P5. Follow HTTP stream again.
Question.
Yes.
Why was the PNG file?
Because there was only one PNG file.
Just because of the PNG.
Yeah, because we have a, you know, we're loading this site, we're looking for flags. There's one image and only one image, and the name was something kind of obtuse. Take a glance at it. I mean, that's a lot of this is, it's kind of phishing. You're out there rummaging through data going, what catches my eye today? When I see one image and one image only, yeah, I'm going to take a look at it. If I see 500 images, okay, maybe I'm not going to check every one of them. Is there one with a weird name? Is there one from a site? Maybe then it does make more sense. We can do that export all, dump it to a folder, and try and load the HTML page with all the elements. And we can see everything a bit easier. I've done the save all and dump them into a folder and then just expand it and see thumbnails of everything. Gives you a quick at a glance. Oh, hey, I found a thing. All right, so, oh, hey, conveniently. So does anything stick out to anyone here? There's something real interesting right there. Flags. Flags, please. And something that's formatted fairly close to, the same case as what we're normally used to for that SecDSM and some random letters, but that's not SecDSM. Anyone back in the internet old farts day, BBSs? How did you hide things before we had those stupid spoiler tags everywhere? Rot 13. So we could go out ahead and grab a... If we want to say grab this string, let's flip over. Get our handy dandy Rot 13 decoder. What? cheap and easy. Let's say this one's all JavaScript. You're good. We're local. But yep, so we can throw it in Rot 13 to code. There we have a flag. Throw this in. Hey, there was our missing flag. There's our part one. So we go back to it, though. We still have flags 3 and 4 to look at. We have a 114 and something that was base64 encoded. 114, if we go look at, we pretty much exhaust our HTTP stuff, or at least it's a good guess, because we only had two that were named 8 legs for a spider. So what could we have to work with here? Let me clean up a couple of windows. Again, 2 monitors, 3 monitors helps a ton in this one, because you should see when I get going digging into stuff at work, I'll have packet, 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 packet. So again, we go back into our statistics, and let's start looking at, say, some of our conversations. So this just gives us an idea of who was talking to who where. So we have Ethernet, we have all our IPv4. We can see we have a fair number of, you know, there's only one client involved, this 10.0.2.15, a couple of different servers they hit. Shows various amounts transferred. Maybe we'll take a look and, port numbers would help with context. So we can jump up and look at TCP streams. We have some web traffic. We can click on one of these and sort, just because we want to be quick about it. Hey, port 21 showed up. Port 21, FTP traffic. You know, that's somewhere to go. And thinking back on that hint, 114. Anyone know their RFCs of lore? RFC 114 talks about the file transfer protocol, FTP. So kind of a good thing. A lot of those hints, again, might not make sense going forward, but are a great way to double check yourself going backwards. So odds are, yeah, this flag is probably embedded somewhere in FTP. We can either find it filter, or we could just say, look for FTP. Where was our FTP data? All right, we're gonna follow this TCP stream. Oh, all right, we got nothing. They tried to log in, so that was one connection, because we saw we had two separate connections, so there was 38. So let's go look at filter by FTP again. We had 38. Jump back down. Hey, what do we got? We got another flag. Boom, throw that password in. Casual reminder, FTP, passwords in the clear. Quit using it. So is SMTP. Just tunnel everything over SSH. It's fine. Put some basic security on it. You know, or HTTPS. So hey, we got a third flag there. That's awesome. We're cruising along. So we want to jump back through. We're going to take a look at that weird name we had. We had MZCONW equal equal. Again, handy dandy tools online because we're working on the fly here. So we have a capital MZCONW equal equal. Got to decode. Doesn't look quite right. Double check transcription. Yep, so maybe we try, okay, maybe it's not UTF, maybe they went straight ASCII on us. Or I really just typoed something. Oh, yeah. Zero. Guess another great note. Be careful, typos happen. They happen a lot, they hurt. You'll spend hours chasing something, a flag that wasn't there because you typoed something wrong. But 3747. All right, what can we do with that one? We've done RFC. If we go back through and see if anything jumps out at us. We're going to pop back to our conversations. What do we have to work with? Sort by our ports. Hey, we have a connection on port 3747. Pretty good clue, whatever we're looking for is probably there. We're gonna go ahead and apply as filter, selected AB. This automatically builds that filter for us so we can see that connection. Again, let's go see what we got. Follow that TCP stream. Oh man, cakewalk. Wonder what this flag could be. There we go. Where are we at here? About half an hour with all our setup time and some introductions, and we already have our first four flags done. We're motoring.
That's how long it took you real fast, too.
Yeah, actually, a bit faster because I wasn't stopping to explain everything.
4 hours to get the first flag submitted.
Yeah. Yep. So we can jump through and go, what do we got for our next challenge? We went ahead and kicked these butts. Some of the tools, again, we used to recap. We followed TCP HTTP streams, exported HTTP objects. We were looking at that protocol hierarchy, what conversation. I wasn't digging into DNS, but you can dig in DNS, HTTP, and requests. That statistics tab. Just grab a PCAP sometime and go play with it. There's a wealth of information you're going to find just by exploring data that you know what it is already. You'll find faster ways to do this. So some notes on some of the stuff we went through. Flag 5, Samuel. Hey, we get a new PCAP. This time it's just for a single one. So what do we got? We got open recent. Flag 5. All right, we have a ton of weird data here. If you can see, there's this color code bar on the side. So we're going to see things like anything red. These are reset packets. This is a nasty connection. It's muddled. There's all sorts of errors. If we really wanted to see what kind of idea, like how bad this is, we could actually go into analyze and look at expert information. Man, there is 6,000 connection resets. This thing is a mess. Couple of chats, you know, like I said, this is sort of details at a glance. These may or may not be relevant. These tools are based off a lot of the stuff for actually doing real network troubleshooting. You know, if you're trying to troubleshoot why something's slow and you open it and find 6,000 connection resets, hey, I think you found your problem as to what was making something slow. Some IPS system has gone awry. So, again, we're going to start same place we start every time. We're going to go, what do we got for protocol hierarchy? What do we have for data? We have a, like, 12 DNS packets. Not a lot to work on. There's something, like, one TLS packet, ICMP. But, man, there's a lot of just general TCP traffic. There's a lot of stuff unclassified. All right. Maybe we figure out where it's going. Obviously, Wireshark can't decode it into something. It's something odd. So we're going to go ahead and say, let's look at our conversations. out as I'm scrolling through. Look at the number of packets. Most of these connections have 1 to 2 packets each. For TCP traffic, that's a handshake. You have a SYN packet, a SYNAC, and that's about it. You know, these things are basically just barely setting up, and or that's where our reset packets are getting generated by. We're hitting ports that aren't open. For us trying to find a flag, there's probably not going to be data in these. These are mostly blank packets. We can see same thing, the bits. There's almost no data transferred here. But if we sort by, we can go ahead and just sort by number of packets. One connection stands out pretty quick. This one has 38 packets. Next highest is 5 and then 3. This would be where I would start, because this one actually has some form of a useful data amount that maybe we can start somewhere with it. We can go down here. We're just going to follow our stream. That looks interesting to me. But I'm also a licensed ham radio operator. I look at this and go, oh, Morse code, of course. Going back to our hint, does anyone remember the name of the flag?
Samuel.
So again, our hint that this is probably Morse code, this is our flag. Because if we think about it, we know 3 dots is an S. SEC, DSM. But again, we have random garbage. It's kind of hard to follow, so we're just going to copy everything wholesale. Solve everything like we do. Just Google it. Hey, look, someone wrote a Morse code translator. Ding, there's our key. We need a little polish it. We need to put our curly brackets around it. We're done. This was the clutch 10 minutes in before the thing closed up, and I'm like, oh, we packed up AV. What do we do? Pop in. Here we go. Because, again, you saw how quick it was. We did that protocol hierarchy, looked at the connections, goes immediately. Let's filter out these 30,000 connections or how many hundreds of connections there, narrow it down to 1 pretty quick. What's on what? I do not have the audio pipe through here, so. Morse code translator was great. All right. Top, what's next? Let's see, where are we at for time? 7:30. Couple of these, I'll admit, this was one that still has me stumped. I'm still working on this one. This one is a multidiscipline, and I'm awful at great at packet analysis, not so great at other ones. What was that? Oh, I know. Yep. So if we do that, it is the wandering albatross.
Of course.
It's a good hint. It gives us something to work with. So again, we're gonna clean up our 15 windows I left all over the place. Open recent. Let's go grab our challenge number 6. On to the next challenge. Same way we start anywhere. Anyone seeing a pattern yet on how I approach this stuff? Protocol hierarchy. What do we got? We got some DNS traffic. Might be interesting to look at. We have TLS. We have HTTP. And 1 JPEG that gets transferred. Well, as we know, HTTP is a real easy one. Let's look at DNS this time. Do statistics. DNS, what do we got? 274 DNS packets. It's mostly A record lookups and some responses for it. Nothing jumps out as crazy here. My guess is this is something they were using to generate that filler traffic. As you've seen, all these have all kinds of data floating around on them. So there's going to be some background radiation we have to filter out. That's the whole point of the challenge here, is to tell what's the signal from the noise. So we'll keep doing our statistics. We're going to hop down and look at our HTTP feeds. Let's go look at our HTTP requests. Given that our clue and title of the flag was the Wandering Albatross, does one of these perhaps stick out to anybody? Again, we're looking for an Albatross JPEG. So again, let's go narrow that one down. We're going to say export objects. selected. And go to our JPEG. Right click and let's jump down. Oh, if you see, we do not have the same option to just go on ahead and view it here. Show packet bytes, maybe. Hold on. Show. There we go. All right. Can't see any. All right, so we have an albatross. This is not quite as obvious as the other flag. Actually, pretty sure South American. So, this may be a chain thing. So sometimes we like to include other challenges, other cross disciplines besides network analysis in this. So this would be a good candidate of, we have an image, we have a good indicator that this might be our flag. So perhaps we want to start doing into some sort of like steg analysis. Well, we can go on ahead and actually use this export. We're going to export objects. We're going to say, give us our HTTP object. Click it. Save it. Let's just dump a file into downloads. Away we go. Now our file is down there. We can go on ahead and chain that into other tools to do post analysis on it. My Stego skills are kind of non-existent, so I'm learning. It's been 3 days. Cut me some slack here. I had a presentation to throw together. All right, so we pass this off to one of our other teammates who's good at crypto and Steg analysis. Let them go find the flag. Divide and conquer. work your strengths. I'm good at packet analysis. Let me churn out data for someone else to go work on. So we are going to chug forward. All right, so we got 7 and 8. Both of these flags, again, come out of the same PCAP. We have an in name only, and we have a Lego. So in name only, name servers maybe, name services. It's going to be a name of something. Host fields, probably a good way to work on it. Lego, I think blocks, so it's some sort of blockchain, block cipher, something block related. Clean up some windows. Back in, what do we got? Let's go open, 7, 8. Again, starting the same place we always start. Let's go look at our protocol hierarchy. DNS traffic, TLS traffic, net BIOS, SMB, server message block protocol. We had a hint of Legos. We have a protocol that talks about blocks. Sounds like a logical place to start. Why don't we'll skip over flag 7 for a second. We'll jump straight to 8 and go see what we can do for analysis there. We also got HTTP. Tell you what, while we're just doing a quick glance, let's run through our protocols quick. DNS, whoa. Compared to the other ones we looked at that were all A and AA records, or in quad A, this one has a whole bunch of text record lookups, MX records, CNAMEs. CNAMEs don't necessarily throw as a weird flag for me, but text records do, and 63 MX record lookups is really unusual for me, especially because in our protocol hierarchy, we didn't see SMTP anywhere. We did have a hint of it's in a name, DNS name resolution. Hey, I think we may have found where our flag 7 might be, but we'll come back to that one. So yeah, we're just gonna go through, let's look at a quick HTTP to see what was there. Oh, hey, our albatross is back. Gee, great. but also this hit to Chris Sanders' blog, linking to an image about SMB carving. Pull up the image, it's kind of a generic image, but if we go through and look at the site, we just throw in Chris Sanders and SMB carving. Hey, he has a whole article on how to extract files out of PCAPs. It's a little convoluted. There's a lot of steps involved. And that's back from Wireshark, like, 2-3 days? We've come a little longer. So we can either go follow his article and spend the next 20 minutes painfully carving out one message block at a time, attacking them together. Or we go visit our handy friend, Export Objects, SMB. Oh, we got a flog and a wavy.zip. So the flog, let's go ahead and we'll just throw a save all in here. Let's go throw that in our downloads. Chuck them both in there. And let's go see what we got. So we got a flog. This flog is maybe garbage, maybe not. But I'm guessing it was something there just to annoy us, a little red herring, make us spend time carving this out if, you know, we didn't know the 3-button clicks to do it in Wireshark for us.
That's a password.
Yep. ASDF, ASDF, ASDF. All right. What's in this wavy zip? Wavy? Hey, flag. Password. ASDF. ASDF, ASDF. Nothing. Womp. All right. So again, at this point, we know we have another flag that we could start chasing. We saw there was some DNS traffic. We make a decision. Either we start digging more, trying to find the flag, or, hey, we have a guy on our team that has, 8 GPUs crammed in a box for doing crypto hash cracking. Why don't we just send him a zip file and go, hey, while you're there, could you look at this thing funny until it falls over? So we pass this off and see what they got. So let's go back. We'll take a look at the that weird DNS traffic. So we're just going to filter for DNS. Run through here, take a quick glance. Huh. Those are really weird name servers. DNS cat. So again, takes us to our Google, throw in DNS cat, what do we got? We have DNS cat, we have DNS cat 2. DNS cat's deprecated, everyone's on DNS cat 2. If we want to dig into the protocol a little bit, you can see that we only have one gnarly string of characters instead of a whole bunch of dotted notation. We're using DNS cat 2. So this is where, if you are a logical, insane person, you go on ahead and extract this file. Let's say we want to just grab this traffic. We could go on ahead and say, all right, we see this is all to one specific server. We're going to apply a filter. Not just their destination, we want all their traffic. So here is all of our traffic for just this that we have selected. It's just our between these two hosts, or this one server involved. And let's, in case there's anything weird, let's filter in and we'll just add a DNS filter on top of it. So we know we just have DNS traffic and the related ICMPs for the error codes for the DNS. We can go ahead, we could say export specified packets. We could say just the displayed packets instead of all 2,000 captured. And if you don't have a giant screen, there's a, oh, there we go, save button. So we can hit save. Dump these files off in a PCAP. We can run these through secondary tools. T-shark is a great one, the command line Wireshark. We could T-shark it out, extract certain key fields that we want, dump it into your, chain in the little awk, little sed, cut, shift, hip hip hurrah, maybe we got something. But this is a talk on advanced Wireshark techniques, so it wouldn't be any fun if I didn't get a little masochistic. Anything that we could do with a command line, I should be able to do with Wireshark. It was really nice of these guys to have these dissectors like domain name, where I can go ahead and drill down. I can see the packet decoded and get the flags, get all the data out of it. That's handy. We use that for HTTP. We use it for a couple other things. Wouldn't it be really great if we could do that for this DNS cat protocol? So outside of the confines of the CTF, when I'm sitting here with, man, I should have a project and get something spiffy for this talk, I went, all right, I know you can write your own dissectors for Wireshark. How hard could it be? So, again, let's just start with Google. Google DNS cat Wireshark dissector. Anyone got something? We do get an article. We get an article that came up from someone that wrote one for DNS cat V1 protocol for Wireshark 1.6. The dissector doesn't work at all. Won't even load, has some issues. And when you do port it and go through all the hassle of getting it to work with current Wireshark, it still freaks out because this is DNS Cat 2 traffic, new and improved. So we start digging. Let's go dig in the protocol. What we find out is DNS Cat can be encrypted or it can be plain text. I'm just having a gimme here. If I were seeing this in the field, I would probably assume it's most likely encrypted because, well, actually, no, I wouldn't assume that. I'd double check anyway because sometimes attackers are really dumb. They're finding their tools on Google just like we are. But, you know, if it were encrypted, wouldn't be too much. And they're not giving us another password. Odds are this might be plain text. This is already a high enough hurdle to jump through for a CTF flag. We're only getting, what, 100, 200 points out of this thing? They're probably not going to make this too impossible and expect us to crack a password on something we decode all the way. That's the ninth flag. But just because it was interesting for me, I'm like, okay, let's go ahead and try and write a dissector. Wireshark has this idea of post-dissectors. They're extra Lua scripts. Anyone write any Lua here? Good. Means no one can critique how bad mine is. Lua's... That's the EULA. Close. Now, EULA is a, or a, oh man, now you got me doing it. Lua is a scripting programming language that's commonly used for add-ons and modules for other utilities. For example, if anyone's played any halfway recent MMO that has custom add-ons, World of Warcraft, Elder Scrolls Online, something like that, all of those UI add-ons are almost always written in Lua. Nmap has all its Lua scripts. There's lots of resources for Lua. It's great because it's, from a programming aspect, it's real easy to put in a Lua decoder, and people can write modules, load them in, do fun stuff. So I didn't want to get into writing an entire dissector. I wanted to look at a post-dissector. The difference being a full dissector, you basically have access to your raw packet dumps. You need to extract all your data. Ain't nobody got time for that. We're going to look at a post-dissector, which is run, it's called after all of the normal dissectors have had a chance to go, and I can leverage their stuff. Since I know this only works on DNS traffic, it makes way more sense for me to invoke a post-dissector and just leverage all the work that that DNS dissector did. It's already going to extract host names for me. It's going to figure out our message types and provide that an easy flag so I don't have to go digging through hex offsets to figure out what I want. So, from a what started off as a awfully plagiarized script from our Diablo Horn, the guy that wrote the DNS Cat one, I started with that one and just started deleting and retyping things until it got to be working, and then got really ashamed of how bad the code was and tried my best to hide the mess. But just kind of walk you through some of the basics. Turns out this was, after figuring out the minimum required setup for it, it was actually a lot easier than I thought it would be. You know, again, this is coming from someone, I've never touched Lua. I did this in about 2-3 hours, including trying to make the old one work, fighting it, realizing why it didn't, and then resigning myself to actually having to learn to write something if I want something fun to present. Got our basic print statements. You know, we're gonna look at some field dissectors, which is basically we're gonna, here's some data that I want to grab from existing dissectors. Again, we said that we're going to run after those. So we're going to look at, you know, we're going to declare some fields we want. I want to look at UDP destination and source post because I need to know, is this a query response, is this a request or a response? I could also probably dig this out of DNS. It just seemed easier to do it with a source desk port because, again, that's how the DNS cat one was coded. We also need to know what our DNS query name was. We need to know what the response type was, and then we know, we saw there were CNAMEs used, there were MX records used, there were text records used. Pull up DNS Cat 2 for the application. Their entire protocol is documented. So it was real easy from their protocol to go, oh, all right, here's the different kinds of records, here separately. So we're just going to declare a couple of fields. These are things that I want to display. I want to display the raw request and the raw response. This is mostly for feedback while I'm writing the thing, going, hey, am I even halfway close? You know, I want to do the data, and I want to be able to show the length. The length is a big one for me just because turns out, as you see, there's going to be a whole lot of data, and not all of it might have a payload for it. There's just a lot of session data of it trying to set up and keep this DNS cat channel alive. So being able to filter by length gives us a quick way to go, where's actual data we can use? We cram all our fields together in a structure, not a big deal. Declare some local variables. Then basic, real rudimentary if logic. Let's make sure that it's actually DNS. If not, quit processing. Because this is going to try to run on every single packet. So anything we can do to kick out exit codes quick is going to speed up our processing. Otherwise, the first time I ran this, I didn't have those checks, and it took all of 10 minutes watching this little progress bar go, post-analysis, and then 30,000 error messages going, hey, this isn't a DNS packet. I don't have these variables. You know, and we need to know what kind of record type is it, how are we going to handle it. Some quick length checks just to make sure that we have big enough. Again, because we have clean DNS traffic, we only want to find DNS cat. Turns out the minimum string length for that that object is 18 characters. So we know if it's DNS packet, it doesn't have at least 18 characters to work with, throw it out, it's not DNS cat. Figure out, again, source destination is just kind of stuff to be clean. Are we looking at the query name? Are we looking at the DNS query? Or are we looking at our response headers? How do we handle those response headers? And then we're going to parse the data. Get data, we're stripping it off. As you saw, all of them had this optional prefix, so standard string option. Let's just trim off this DNS cat. It's junk. And then we're going to take a look at, there's an optional thing for DNS cat where it could be a real domain name so it doesn't look stupidly obvious. There may or may not be a DNS cat at the beginning, then there's string of characters, and then there's an optional tailing header. So that's this rips off the front half, this rips off the back half, gets us just to raw data. And let's chug it in for processing. Long story short, all we're doing is looking to see if these are hex characters. It pulls them up in pairs, and it's actually hex characters encoded as in ASCII. So we're just going ASCII characters, or ASCII, yeah, pairs into hex. Again, T-Shark, couple of fields, cut, pipe it to XXD. You have a flag, but here we are. Chance for new skills. Yep, and as you can see, I saw the first, the 19, or the first 18 characters of protocol characters. So we just flat out discard all of them and start at the 19th character. If I really wanted, and kind of as a thought for fun, I was debating on going through and looking at all the weird fun stuff that DNS cat supports, like session data, see which ones are send flags, receive flags, all the basically flush out the full protocol so I could do full DNS cat analysis here. But for the sake of this one, I'm like, all right, I'm kind of in over my head. I'm starting to see the top. Maybe we can do this. Let's just get our raw data string commands. So we're going to grab those and decode them. So we can go ahead and take this. We just chuck it into the Wireshark folder and give it a run. I have a batch file because I had to run this thing over and over and over to make him work. But all we do is we're going to call Wireshark. And we're going to specify X Lua script, and then feed it our Lua script. So this is going to tell it, go on ahead and do your normal disassembly, and then once that, or your normal pre-analysis, when that's done, run this Lua script post-dissector, let it have a chance at the packets too. So we launch. You see it takes a little bit longer as it's checking integrity on that script. We're going to say open recent. We are, what, on 7.8? And as you can see, for non-DNS cat ones, we don't have any kind of domain names. So let's go filter out where we want to look for DNS. We know it was a query name. can see, we actually now have DNS cat. So because we did register our own dissector, I could just go, hey, show me all our DNS cat traffic. So we have all our DNS cat traffic. Let's go see what we got. We have decoded data. Again, any one of these fields, we want to look at this at glance, we're going to apply as column. Throw in a column, we got decoded data. It's issuing command to owner PC and bunches of blank data. We exported length for a reason. Let's use it. So dscat and dscat.length is greater than zero. Dscat length is greater than zero. So we're going to filter it and only show packets with relevant data. Command. Hey. Got ourselves a flag. Again, roundabout way, but you know what? I now have a Lua script. I can put this in the CTF toolkit. Next time we come across a DNS cat, I know what module to load up. Boom, we got something. So this is kind of how you grow those toolkits organically. You find tools you like, you add scripts in the off season. A lot of these CTFs are left up. So like BSides Iowa at least is still running as of, oh, it killed it finally. All right, so you go in and scrape the data off quickly so you have something to work out in the postseason for fun. But put your tools back so that next time you come up, we can hit it harder, we can hit it faster. You have more tools at your disposal, and it's a chance to learn. It's a good chance to flex some skills. Again, into this, I had no idea for Lua scripting, but, you know, I can do this now. This is something that at work I might approach and maybe write some dissectors for some of our proprietary protocols that we do. Because, hey, we have it, and it would be handy for my analysis. Alright, jump through stuff. Any questions? Yes. I'm sorry, what was that? What's Wireshark cost? Free. It is a free tool. Wireshark.org. They have some pro models if you want any of the professional training. They offer that. They have a SharkFest user conference meeting. They have some custom packet capture hardware. So if you want a network tap that dumps out PCAPs at 40 gig, they got you covered. That's where they're going to make their money. But otherwise, the actual analysis tool, all free. Yep.
So two of the flags with that first PCAP,
mm-hmm.
You actually get just by searching the file on the editor?
Yeah, absolutely.
I know you're talking about that.
And that's exactly it. I mean, like I said, there's faster tools. Grep is a great one just to throw at stuff. Yeah, strings. Chuck strings and grep, away you go. But again, Wireshark tools, these are things I was comfortable with. I can roll through and hammer this out. But again, this is a lot of what I do for work. So I have the tools I'm comfortable and quick with, and everyone's got to work on their personal skill set, what they got. So. Yeah, you can. All of these, there's multiple ways to solve it. Again, they highlighted at the SMB carving video that walks you through how to do actual block dissection. Really great talk if anyone's interested in it, but file, export, protocol, SMB, save. Yep.
Are you going to publish your plugin?
Am I going to publish the plugin? It's already up on my GitHub. Okay, I threw it in the SecDSM one. Yep, I'll throw it up there. Did I throw the PCAPs up already on ours? Okay. Yeah, so the PCAPs are up there if anyone wants to dig in and play with some of that stuff. If someone really, really wants, I can give you my awful, awful slides. They're mostly my speaker notes here, but they might walk you through a little bit.
I don't think you ever explained what DNS cat is.
Yeah. What I read in my 10 minutes of Googling it, DNS cat looks like a exfiltration tool for tunneling data over DNS. Seems really popular with a lot of CTF stuff, a lot of the big certifications, because who's monitoring and logging DNS?